Yeah, so we start with page 104, The Sanctification of Married Life, a redirection to these two chapters, starting page 103 and then 104. So we will finish that with all your permission. So Married Life, a Spiritual Enterprise. I request all of you to go on mute. As most persons enter into married life as a matter of course, but marriage will become a help or a hindrance. Will become a help or a hindrance according to the manner in which it is handled. There is no doubt that some immense spiritual possibilities are accessible through married life, but all this depends upon having the right attitude. From the spiritual point of view, married life will be a success only if it is thoroughly determined by the vision of truth. It cannot offer much if it is based upon nothing more than the limited motives of mere sex, or if it is inspired by considerations that usually prevail in a business partnership. It has to be undertaken as a real spiritual enterprise that is intended to discover what life can be at its best. When the two partners launch together upon the spiritual adventure of exploring the higher possibilities of the spirit, they cannot at the outset limit their experiment by any nice calculations concerning the nature and amount of individual gain. Section is married life, utterly different from promiscuity. Married life almost always makes many demands upon both partners for mutual adjustment and understanding, and creates many problems that were not originally expected. Though this might, in a sense, be true of life in general, it is particularly true of married life. In married life, two souls get linked in many ways, with the result that they are called upon to tackle the whole complex problem of personality rather than any simple problem created by some isolated desire. This is precisely why married life is utterly different from promiscuous sexual relations. Promiscuous sex attempts to separate the problem of sex from other needs of the developing personality and seeks to solve it in isolation from them. Although this kind of solution might seem to be easy, it turns out to be very superficial and has the further disadvantage of sidetracking aspirants from attempting the real solution. Married life calls forth sublimation. The relative values of the various sides of the limited personality can best be appreciated when they become intertwined and appear in varied settings and perspectives. It is difficult to discriminate between them if they appear fitfully in a disconnected series. In married life, there is ample room for varied experience, with the result that the different tendencies latent in the mind begin to organize around the crystallized scheme of married life. I'll just mute all. Yeah, it's difficult to discriminate between them if they appear fitfully in a disconnected series. In married life, there is ample room for varied experience, with the result that the different tendencies latent in the mind begin to organize around the crystallized scheme of married life. This organization of varied purposes not only provides an unlimited field for discrimination between the higher and lower values, but also creates between them a necessary tension which requires and calls forth effective and intelligent sublimation. Right. Conditions of marriage precipitate changes in inner life. In one sense, married life may be looked upon as the intensification of most human problems. As such, it becomes the rallying ground for the forces of bondage as well as for the forces of freedom, the factors of ignorance as well as the factors of light. As the married life of ordinary persons is determined by mixed motives and considerations, it inevitably invites an uncompromising position between the higher and the lower self. Such opposition is necessary for the wearing out of the lower self and drawing of the true divine self, and the dawning of the true divine self, married life develops so many points of contact between two souls that severance of all connection would mean the unsettlement and disarrangement of practically the whole tenor of life. Since this difficulty of breaking away from one another invites and precipitates inner readjustment, marriage is really a disguised opportunity for the souls to establish a real and lasting understanding that can cope with the most complex and delicate situations. The spiritual value of married life is directly related to the nature of the preponderant factors that determine its daily course. If it is based upon shallow considerations, it can deteriorate into a partnership in selfishness aimed against the rest of the world. The section is married life must be in line with divine plan. If it is inspired by lofty idealism, it can rise to a fellowship that not only requires and calls forth increasingly greater sacrifices for each other, but actually becomes a medium through which the two souls can offer their united love and service to the whole family of humanity. When married life is thus brought into direct line with the divine plan for the evolution of the individuals, it becomes a pure blessing for the children who are the fruit of the marriage, for they have the advantage of absorbing a spiritual atmosphere from the very beginning of their earthly career. Married life enriched by children. Though the children are thus the beneficiaries of the married life of the parents, the married life of the parents is in turn enriched by the presence of the children. Children give to parents an opportunity for expressing and developing a real and spontaneous love in which sacrifice becomes easy and delightful. And the part played by children in the life of parents is of tremendous importance for the spiritual advancement of the parents themselves. It therefore follows that when children make their appearance in married life, they ought to be wholeheartedly welcomed by the parents. Birth control is the next section. In view of the claims that children have on married lives, birth control deserves careful attention and critical examination. The question must not be considered from the point of view of any special or limited interest, but from the standpoint of the ultimate well-being of the individuals and society. The right opinion in this regard, in this respect, as in all respects, must above everything be based upon spiritual considerations. The attitude that most persons have toward birth control is oscillating and confused because it contains an admixture of good and bad elements. While birth control is right in its aim of securing the regulation of population, it is disastrously unfortunate in the choice of its means. There can be no doubt that the regulation of childbearing is often desirable for personal and social reasons. Uncontrolled breeding intensifies the struggle for existence and may bring about a social order where ruthless competition becomes inevitable. Apart from creating a responsibility for parents, which they may be unable to adequately discharge, it becomes an indirect and contributory cause of crime, war, and poverty. Though humane and rational considerations demand and justify all serious attempts to regulate the birth of children, the use of physical means for securing this purpose remains fundamentally indefensible and unjustifiable. Physical means remove incentive for mental control. The purely physical means generally advocated by the supporters of birth control are most objectionable from the spiritual point of view. Although the physical means of birth control are advocated on humanitarian grounds, they are almost always used by the generality of people to serve their own selfish ends and to avoid the responsibility of bearing and bringing up children. Since the physical consequences of yielding to lust can be so successfully avoided through the use of these means, those who have not begun to awaken to the higher values have no incentive to moderation in the gratification of passion. They thus become victims of excessive indulgence and bring about their own physical, moral, and spiritual ruin by neglecting mental control and becoming slaves to animal passion. mental control indispensable for rising from passion to peace. The easy use of physical means obscures the spiritual side of the question and is far from contributory to the awakening of individuals to their real dignity and freedom as spiritual beings. Thoughtless and uncontrolled indulgence must inevitably lead to reaction and spiritual bondage. For spiritual aspirants in particular, but also for all human beings, because they are all potentially spiritual aspirants, it is extremely inadvisable to rely upon physical means for the regulation of childbearing. For such regulation, the individuals must rely upon nothing but mental control. Mental control secures the humanitarian purposes that inspire birth control, but keeps clear of the spiritual disasters entailed by the use of physical means. Mental control is not only useful for regulating the number of children, but is also indispensable for restoring to humanity its divine dignity and spiritual well-being. Only through the wise exercise of mental control is it possible for humanity to rise from passion to peace, from bondage to freedom, and from animality to purity. In the minds of thoughtful persons, the much ignored spiritual side of this question must assume the importance it deserves. I think we have covered quite a bit of concepts. So if you want to take a pause and discuss, I think this might be a good point. I muted all by force this time. So who wants to jump in can just unmute and start. So I think he starts by, the first one. Yeah, it's a very interesting way of looking at marriage, and I think it's the right way.
At this point, where it says the organization of various purposes, same point where you were there earlier. Sublimation, there's something.
Married life calls forth sublimation.
Throw some light on. So, what exactly is, can you come to that part?
Is this the part? Your audio is bad, but I think you're referring to married life calls forth sublimation.
Yes. Sublimation. You were on that part just a little while ago. Just have to scroll up or down.
Yeah, I'm on that part right now. Can you see my screen? Yeah, Kama, any comments on this? You're on mute, probably.
The organization of varied purposes not only provides an unlimited field for discrimination, that part.
Okay, I think its organization of varied purposes not only provides an unlimited field for discrimination between the higher and lower values, but also creates between them a necessary tension which requires and calls forth effective and intelligent sublimation. They are like high sounding words, but what I have understood is basically that, if you go back to the couple of other chapters that we have read, the previous chapter and the one on significance of male and female incarnations, I mean, if you look at the big picture, the purpose of the soul is to go from unconscious divinity to conscious divinity. That is the big picture we need to keep in mind. But the soul or the consciousness of the soul has to go through this whole evolution, reincarnation. Now, this is where in the reincarnation process, where we are still in the gross, we are using the gross body to experience the gross, subtle and mental worlds. We deal with the five physical senses, touch, taste, sound, smell, sight. And as Baba said, man suffers from lust of the gross body, greed of the subtle body, and anger of the mental body. Convert lust into love, greed into generosity, and anger into passionate tolerance. So these are what you call as the spiritual values that we need to kind of imbibe. But because of, as I said earlier, due to evolution, we have, this aspect of, sexual duality, and also the coarser desires. So what it says out here is it possible for us to go from the coarser desires to the finer desires? Now, this can happen only when we understand this whole process, you know, what we call as the divine theme. So one aspect here where he talks about the different tendencies latent in the mind. So again, I go back to the psychological tendencies which we talked about in the chapter on significance of male and female incarnations. So in that chapter, we understood that the soul is non-dual. The soul has no gender. The consciousness of the soul either has a male body or a female body. And because the soul wants to feel complete, the male and female get attracted to each other. But here again, in this whole chapter, we have seen that something called awaken to higher values, then divine dignity and spiritual well-being. So the whole purpose of this, of marriage is that if you are not able to be celibate, you know, being a householder is good. Having one partner is good. And we have seen from examples of different perfect masters, such as, you know, there were householders like Tukaram and Kabir and Guru Nanak who were householders. And there are people like, Ramana Maharshi who were celibate. So it all depends on each soul. And so this effective and intelligent sublimation, this word sublimation, you will come across in another chapter called the last chapter, God is Infinite Love. So I don't want to keep, this chapter, every paragraph has got something, you can write a thesis on it kind of thing, you know. So I think it's just about how we go from lower values, which is coarser desires, to higher values, which I believe is the finer desires, you know. So I hope I made sense. Jai Baba.
Thanks. I have another question in the last paragraph. Can you all hear me? Last paragraph, there's a lot of talk about, you know, how to collaborate together. So is this concept something about the soul and mate? I don't know whether it's relevant here, but in the last paragraph, they say that the marriage, one can contribute to humanity. And
can you say which page and which para?
Yeah. Mental control secures the humanitarian purpose. Which paragraph are you referring to?
On page 107, in the bottom section. Bottom section.
Mental control secures humanitarian purpose.
Here, in this paragraph.
So what's the question?
The question is that is there something like a soulmate who jointly together deal with humanitarian purposes? What is the significance of this actually?
Can somebody else answer this, please?
It's out of syllabus. Soulmate, Bob. I have not seen Bob talking about anywhere.
I will comment about it maybe. From both spiritual and maybe from the, you know, physical world, I am married and I'm also living in a married relationship, so I can comment about it. So I think the other section of sublimation, I think it is talking about, I think it is very important to express the emotions and, whatever one might feel in married life, if you don't have the freedom to be yourself and be free to say and take, it's an experimental field where Baba is asking us to experiment fully and don't be artificial and just be yourself in the married life. And it calls for, it is a risk because it calls for an intelligent action in doing that. So it is merely saying that there is an opportunity to do that and be yourself in that sublimation section. And here it is birth control and mental control. He's talking about when you get involved in sex and all that stuff, when you go overboard with it and when you are given all this birth control measure options available, there is a chance that people will overindulge in it because there is no risk. Because children are considered to be children, which is a result of sex, is considered to be a burden for human beings because you have to upbring the children and all that. Now, if that option is given to human beings that you cannot can have sex without having with having birth control measures, and then there is overindulgence, and the purpose of marriage is to have children and grow spiritually and upbring children and give them spiritual parenting and all that, that purpose is lost because it gets into overindulgence. So Baba is also talking about the mental control that is required when you are in a married life, and have that practicing that mental control that you will help on the spiritual path. So that is the gist of what I got from this section. And right from, I think, the birth control till here, it talks about mental control.
Thank you.
Can I have a very general ideas on this? Say, living together, two people coming together because of probably sex, but living together, there is a need for love to the other person. This is the training. So when we say the whole concept is you and I are the same, that you have a training over the years to love the other person, and also to, as you beget children, love them, and then from the family, you peter down to the community so that you identify with each one. This is a training process. You should be able to take it like that also.
In fact, that was my takeaway as well. So I think exposing people to these aspects, children, youngsters, and educating them, much like what Kama wants to do, the spiritual side of learning so that you're equipped with it as earlier than later, will help one to take on these emotions, these necessities and these considerations as you age, and make the right decisions, right? So the point of marriage, the point of having children, and all of that, you have to see it in this larger context, like you said, Mama. And for that, being aware of this lower self and the self with the bigger S, everything is important. So my big takeaway is we should be reading and sharing this with youngsters, with people who do not know about all of this. Second, I think that we are going through an intense phase where we are actually seeing this institution destroyed, right? It has already gotten destroyed in the West. And today we see this destroyed in India as well, right? We have seen everywhere how the institution is no longer relevant. I live in an apartment complex where there are at least, dozens or more live-in couples, living here, right? So this is the context which we live in, and you understand from this chapter how this is spiritually very, very debilitating. The marriage institution is not a no-no for a spiritual aspirant and can be used constructively if both are aligned and both are aware. I think that's my big takeaway.
Karthik, I take your point. I think spreading awareness, education, and or maybe incorporating this in education.
I have to say one more thing. I think spreading is one aspect of it, and educating other people is one aspect of it. More than that, it is important to practice ourselves. Just be genuine in marriage. Yeah, the everything starts with self. The journey of things starts with the self. Spreading to other people, teaching the youngsters. We always have this view that youngsters are to be taught. But I think we also need to learn. So I think each one of us who's married or not married, in both instances, we need to understand the sanctification of having a partner in life, how we progress spiritually and where to let go, where to really be very assertive in putting up your points, because we are also, we shouldn't forget that we are also facilitating the growth of the partner. And also we should listen to, because as here in the book we have said that it facilitates the lower self and the higher self. Our lower self, which is sometimes latent, and we think, we keep thinking about very idealistic thoughts we have, but in reality we might be not answering or addressing the concerns that our partner has, and we think that we should just let go of those things and not address those. But might be the partner is holding it and we are not addressing those issues. So it's very important that first we learn, because marriage is a very big institution and there is a important thing. There are lots of things are there that can teach us lessons in our life. And we should be really thankful to our spouse that person is, the spouse is facilitating this learning for us. And because any learning in marriage is called deep learning. I mean, I think it leaves a very deep impression in us. So we should be thankful to the spouse that he or she is facilitating that learning for us. Because of that person, we are growing spiritually. At the same time, we have to bring forward our faculty to enhance the spiritual learning of the spouse by being honest, by being clear, by actually following what Baba said in what should be done in married life. We have to follow those instructions verbatim by doing all of that. That is when the real meaning comes. And when we live, and we have to lead by example. So when we live such life, the children are watching it. We don't have to tell them that what needs to be done. When we live that life, the children obviously watch and they learn more by watching all of us know. So when we do that, the children automatically learn. And these children will go and live the same life, which is what Baba wants, and also tell their friends. So in a way, we have to do this work by living that life and spreading that word very, you know, it is more fruitful that way. That's my way of looking at it.
Brilliant. I think the points you raised were awesome.
Yeah. Beautiful, Vidyaji. The explanation was really very good. And actually, if we develop this attitude, it's not just the family. It's everyone that we get in touch with.
Yes.
In office, in wherever, in the markets and friends and circles. It touches everyone that we get in.
You mean a lot of people who keep blaming public, they keep saying that, you know, my wife is like that, my husband is like that. Now, this is jokes apart when you, it's fine. But otherwise, I think it is very important that we look at the whole thing seriously.
and this is the easiest opportunity that is available to develop those right attitudes that Baba wants us to develop.
You need a lot of balance. You should be getting into fights, of course.
Yes.
So there's, on a lighter note, there is eerie silence from Singapore. This is the real time the joint aspirants should jump in and say something.
I was waiting for that question. No, you want to say something.
They seem to be separated, one in the office and the other in the home.
No, we are in the same room. You'll be so surprised.
Okay.
Quietly listening. Now, I think Vidya summarized it very, very well. So very little for me to say, but the first couple of pages, if we read them carefully and understand them carefully, rest all is a byproduct.
Yes.
I will read a couple of lines again. In married life, two souls get it linked in many ways, with the result that they are called upon to tackle the whole complex problem of personality rather than any simple problem created by some isolated desire. This line is very important. When we get married, it's not just one desire, it's the whole world that we are tackling within the house, outside the house, and we meet we come across the coarser desires and we have to move to the finer desires through this exercise. And everything is intertwined, decisions are joined. Everywhere we have to discuss, argue, fight, agree, this, that. So it's a journey. So I think, again, saying the relative value of the various sides of limited personality can be best, can be appreciated when they become intertwined and appear in varied settings and perspectives. So this is a journey which is together, and we are moving from coarser desires to the finer desires. That's the whole essence of marriage. Then comes children and, you know, birth control and this and that. So that's again, byproducts and smaller, finer aspects of this whole married life. So if we do it fine and we can move to the finer desires together, that's the whole summary, I think.
Jai Baba. In our marriage, the biggest gain for me has been the initiation of Baba into my life. And the seed was sown by Sunil's grandfather, and we are bearing the fruits of that. And it is leapfrogging our growth towards desirable attributes. And so I'm very grateful for that. I've been talking about marriage and everything in that context. Now, I would like to read a letter which Baba has written to Sunil's grandfather in 1943. Can I read that?
Sure.
Yeah, beautiful. Yeah.
So it is, Sunil will maybe share the letter later on the group, but I'll just read it. So it's written from King's Road, Ahmednagar, August 22nd, 1943. To Mr. Trilokinath Dhar, BA LLB, High Court Vakil, Srinagar, Kashmir. Dear Trilokinath, Sri Baba received your letter and was touched by it. He tells you not to worry about anything. The rise and fall, the ups and downs in living and doing are for various reasons, in reasons influenced by sanskaras and circumstances. It is felt at times it is impossible to remove all unwanted thoughts and doing despite resolves and efforts. Sometimes the very thought of curbing oneself of weaknesses becomes a labored imagination, impractical to be put into action. Baba says, positive joy born of love for the highest ideal, a guru, illuminates the darkness of rays of master's blessings. This takes away the necessity of removing darkness and ignorance from our being negatively. Till such time that Baba's darshan is had by you, the brightest means of raising yourself to the heights of receiving grace from him is his name, his picture, his literature, and his constant remembrance through a longing of an affectionate heart. In reaching out to him to love him, Baba says he is in your heart, and you can know it and you will know it. Do not worry for anything at all. He sends his love and blessings. Yours faithfully, I don't know who has written it. I think Adira. Yes. Sunil has shared the letter. Jai Baba. I rewrote this at 3 in the morning. I got up and wrote these words. I was like,
beautiful. It was beautiful. Perfect. Absolutely.
Great.
Yeah. Really beautiful. Thank you for sharing.
Yeah, very nice.
Beautiful. I'd like to say something. I've been married for 36 and a half years, maybe a little longer. You know, when we got married,
it was like not marrying the guy. My father said, you're not getting married to the man, you're getting married to the family. So the entire thing about marriage was completely different, you know. So it was more like a development of and an extension of becoming part of the entire family, looking after that family. It was much more than an interaction between a husband and a wife, you know. But now there's a lot of difference. The institution of marriage is really, the definition of marriage has changed. You know, my son and my daughter-in-law, before they got married, were living together. But to, in their hearts, they thought they were married because they were committed to each other. You know, the ceremony and things like that was not so important to them. So marriage has come a long way. But the children think very differently from what the way we were brought up. And we had, Arvind and myself have had a very beautiful married life. So, but my children, when I see them, they're completely different. So, you know, I can't say that we've been a bad example, but times have changed hell of a lot, you know. Jai Baba. I don't know whether I'm making sense, but.
Interesting. Very, very good point. Yeah, very good.
It's very real, you know. That's what's happening. And the thing is, you always want to question, you know, is this, are we supposed to judge them? Are we supposed to accept it?
No, we have, I don't think we can judge them, because if they say no, I mean, my daughter-in-law's name is Mrigyanka. She's Asmi's girl. So she said, oh no, but we are committed to each other. Why do you want us to get married? And I said, oh my God, you know, now coming from that kind of a family, what do I say to them? I said, no, it'll make me happy. So, you know, they feel that marriage is a ceremony, is hypocrisy. They are committed from the heart. So I don't know what is right, what is wrong. You know, the generation completely thinks differently. You know, they don't want to have children. It's very difficult to judge.
That's why perhaps it's important that this kind of knowledge gets to them while they are in school, because we haven't.
Akshay is a Baba lover. He spends so much time with the Mandali, but you know, he's different. So I mean, maybe that's my karma or his karma. I don't know what. It's very different, you know. Children these days are extremely. See, we got married before we realized what marriage really was. You know, we were so innocent.
Mm.
You know, your father said, oh, you take your gold and you take your silver, give it to your mother-in-law and let her do what she wants. Now, if I tell my daughter, I'm going to give you gold and silver, go and give it to your mother. And she said, Mom, what is wrong with you? You know. So the entire institution of marriage is completely, I don't know whether it's shaky or whether it's real. I just don't know what is the right thing in this.
Marriage basically makes it a public commitment, you know. That you know,
but
commitment
they don't want
between
to do
two people.
Publicly,
yeah, so I mean,
you know, they
yeah,
committed
public,
to their heart.
Yeah, so it's most of the people. It helps actually. Maybe rarely that people you are so committed that public commitment is not necessary. But for most of the people, once I say that I'm married to this in public,
Western values.
Yeah, so it's public commitment. One has to honor his public commitment. So it drives from that.
But there's so many divorces happening. Where is the honoring of public commitment either?
Yeah, that's true as well.
We are in the age where I have my friends where I'm mostly 60% of my friends have got divorced.
Exactly.
So that's the point. I mean, you know, they believe it's a wrong institution completely. That's what they believe. I mean, that's the other way of looking at it completely and from different angle.
Though when Baba got Dara and Amrit married, you know, the ceremony which he had for Dara and Amrit was a very, very sweet, very different kind of a ceremony. Not like these days marriages are so, they spend so much of money, there's so much of wastage, there's so much of this and there's so much of that. And the, you know, marriages these days, the ceremony is an entire waste, you know. Nobody really cares. There's food being wasted. Everything is a waste. And then the marriage doesn't last for more than a year, unfortunately. You know, so.
Yeah. I think
when there has to be education, there has to be education for the children to understand what marriage is, what marriage as an institution is. Yeah, and that all comes from the parents, actually, to be honest with you.
I think from a spiritual standpoint and from the what we are reading, the act of the marriage and the actual publication of the fact that you're married is less important. I'm just drawn by the fact that the two souls work together, right? That aspect needs to be understood by people so that...
That is the most important thing.
Yes, yeah. Right? So as you rightly said, the generations after us are way smarter, way deeper in thinking, and I say this positively, but at the same time, there is also it's also a fact that there is also challenges that they challenge current thinking in extreme ways, right? So they will challenge the fact that the institution of marriage is not important to the point where promiscuity is justifiable, which is a problem, right?
No, so, that maybe is not justifiable,
exactly,
even in their minds, so, but the commitment is only from their heart. They don't need, they don't want, oh,
that is a good point.
Why do you want to
yes. Make know, a public show of it. Yes.
Yeah, you know,
yes.
That is the...
That's a good point. I take that
point. Know each other before they get married. Now, knowing each other, you can't even know a guy after being married to him for 37 years. You know, so that is...
I think Samira, I think it is very important to look at, I understand that you are in this situation because your children are directly connected to you and you are in that children, you are in that situation. But I think if we are counting ourselves as the previous generation and we are counting the next generation as the future generation, and we are talking about bridging this thing and we are trying to judge them and all that, somewhere what we need to look at is how do you relate to this your children, why are they thinking the way they are thinking, why are they behaving the way they are behaving, and
it's not only my children, most children these days you educate.
So I'm coming to that. I think let us not see, first of all, we have not been able to fix our lives properly. We have our limitations and we have our own challenges in our life. So when we judge that most of the children are this or that and all that stuff, maybe there are certain things that we need to look at differently, because the deep structures really matter. When I say deep structure is what they have gone through in their life, what have they seen in the society, what have they seen in their families happening around, all these things influence the children. And what we need to look at every time and all the time is to come back to ourselves and say, what is there for me in this? And we are, because this debate, if we take this debate of why is the younger generation not giving importance, why
it's
are
not the divorced? Younger generation, you know, our generation, also there's so many divorces.
We don't have answers for all those things. We can talk ourselves, but we can't answer for the society.
The only answer to this is, finishing off your sanskars. I mean, that is the only way I can understand.
How do you finish your sanskars? Tell me, Samira, how will you finish your sanskars now?
Well, I think, how will you finish your sanskars in any way? The same way. Through
how will you finish sanskars? Do you know the way your sanskars are working?
No, I don't know how they're working. I'm very ignorant, but I'm just holding on to Baba. I'm taking his name all the time. And I see him working on me all the time. I see him, if I do something wrong, I definitely get I pay for the brunt. I get it back from him in a negative way. So that is the reason, you know, marriages are not some smooth sailing boats, you know. That's why you kind of finish your sanskars in your everyday life.
So I say that we don't know the way sanskaras work. Like Kabir said, apne karam ki gati mein kya janu. So similarly, we do not know how the sanskars work. What are negative sanskars? What are positive sanskars? How is it working? We do not know the way sanskaras work. And when we don't have an answer, if we simply say that this is sanskaras that are working, and we don't have an answer. So if we don't have an answer, and we, the moment we kind of hit that roadblock of we have an answer, like we're blaming it on sanskaras. It is very important to pause and stay in that situation and dwell on it, face it, go through it till you get clarity on that situation.
The fact that I'm a human being, I'm obviously I have a long way to go. Okay, so I am not saying that I'm anywhere.
No one is anywhere. No, there is, so in Baba's world, Baba had coached us, and through his literature also he is saying that let us live a normal life. The moment we need a normal life,
not debate, because there is nothing called normal. Everything is perfect the way it is. According to me, there's nothing. What is normal?
So let us go back to the children. My only observation here was we can relate. We can talk about how is our relationship with the children when they got married and how we look at their relationship and what we feel about the whole
thing. How old are your children?
My children are 23.
Oh, you have a long way to go, darling.
No, this is not. I'm
not going to debate on this anymore.
Thanks.
So
we have two pages to finish. Yeah.
Well, this is karma. I just wanted to point out something that I can only talk about my own personal example. See, all of us understand that each one of us is an individual. We have very unique backgrounds. Some people come from very beautiful Baba families with the right kind of values. Some people come from very abusive families, dysfunctional families, where there is no mentoring. Okay. When Baba was not in my life, I was a completely confused soul, but I was very clear that I needed to get my act right. I went through a very long process, and I always look at the Baba community, the first generation, second generation, 3G, 4G, 5G, and so on. And what I've understood is that I think Samira is very fortunate that, you know, she's been with Baba. And I think that her children, you know, will be able to get influenced by the family atmosphere. So I think overall what I feel is in my own experience of married life and also when I was single, I had no clue about the difference between the male and female gender. I thought males and females thought alike. And then the second thing is one of the biggest spiritual ignorance I had was that I don't know the difference between how the what I call the female hardware and software and the male-female and hardware operates in terms of the physical, emotional, intellectual aspects, what I call the gross body, subtle body, and mental body aspects. So it's a very, very challenging thing. Today we are sitting here and reading Baba, and it's so easy to have this kind of manual. But let me tell you, like, you know, I think that today's generation and previous generation also, I think we are suffering because of ignorance in the way of understanding how nature works. What is the divine plan? So I think what Karthik was saying is also interesting, that it's important that we should make aware. And also what Vidya said is also correct. As parents, we have to set examples. So all of you are very correct. And the last thing I want to say was when Doc Mama was saying, I think he made a very good point. First, I believe is self-love. I think not selfish love, having your ego personality. When does self-love come? To me, it's about self-knowledge. And self-knowledge is based on Baba's God Speaks, discourses, and so on and so forth. But that is only 1%. Then what about the action? You know, self-awareness. That is my challenge every day. How can I be self-aware? Now, when Dog Mama says, ideally, let's say, I've been brought up in a Baba family. I know the literature. Before I get married, how do I want to lead my life? So if I follow it by the book, then I'm in a great spot because I have self-love. Then I can love others. Then I get married. And then in Baba's spiritual world, he has something called LOSS. You know, when we are with a perfect master, first comes love. more than love is obedience, more than obedience is surrender, and more than surrender is sacrifice. So here is a line which says, children give to parents an opportunity for expressing and developing a real and spontaneous love in which sacrifice becomes easy and delightful. So I really agree with Doc Mama what he says. First, and what Vidya said, first comes with you, then the family, then the community, and the whole world. So this is a process, I think, you know, all those interrelationship between different individuals is very unique to each one. But the big picture is we just want to reach that point where we can love everybody without judging them, because everybody is beaten up by their samskaras, you know. Jai Baba.
Okay. So I will continue from page 108. We finished up to 107. Joint responsibility of parenthood. Since the woman has to undertake the trouble and responsibility of bearing and rearing children, she may seem to be affected more seriously by any possible failure in mental control than the man. In fact, it does not mean any real unfairness to the woman. When it is true that the woman has to undertake the trouble and responsibility of bearing and rearing children, she also has the compensating joy of feeding and cuddling them. Thus, the joy of motherhood is much greater than the joy of fatherhood. Further, the man must also face and shoulder the economic and educational responsibilities for the children. In a properly adjusted marriage, there need not be any injustice in the distribution of parental responsibility to be shared between the man and the woman. If both are truly conscious of their mutual responsibility, inconsiderateness will give way to an active and cooperative endeavor to attain full mental control. In the event there is any failure in mental control, they will cheerfully and willingly discharge the joint responsibility of parenthood. Children must be welcome. For those who are not prepared to undertake the responsibility of children, there is only one course left to them. They must remain celibate and practice strict mental control. Though such mental control is extremely difficult to attain, it is not impossible. From the purely spiritual point of view, strict celibacy is best. But since it is so difficult, few can practice it. For those who cannot practice it, the next best course is to marry rather than fall prey to promiscuity. Within married life, one can learn to control animal passion. It is bound to be a gradual process, and in cases of failure in practicing control, the couple must allow nature to take its own course rather than interfere with it through artificial means. They must cheerfully welcome the consequences and be prepared to shoulder the responsibility of bringing up the children. Physical means become addictive. From the spiritual point of view, birth control must essentially be effected through mental control and nothing else. Physical means are under no circumstances advisable, even when the partners seek to use them merely as a provisional and secondary aid without intending to ignore the ideal of developing mental control. While using physical means, they can never arrive at real mental control, though they might truly want it in earnest. On the contrary, they become addicted to the use of physical means and even begin to justify them. To explain still more clearly, what happens in the use of physical means is that while the individuals think they are using them merely as a preliminary step before mental control is fully developed, they actually get addicted to their use and become slaves to the habit. Though they may remain for some time under the delusion that they are trying to develop mental control side by side with the use of physical means, they are actually losing it gradually. In short, mental power is necessarily undermined by reliance on physical means. Thus, the use of physical means is detrimental to the development of self-control and is positively disastrous for spiritual advancement. It is therefore entirely inadvisable, even for the best of motives. Spiritual advancement through married life. In the beginning of married life, the partners are drawn to each other by lust as well as love. But with conscious and deliberate cooperation, they can gradually lessen the element of lust and increase the element of love. Through this process of sublimation, lust ultimately gives way to deep love. By the mutual sharing of joys and sorrows, the partners march on from one spiritual triumph to another, from deep love to ever deeper love, till the possessive and jealous love of the initial period is entirely replaced by a self-giving and expansive love. In fact, through the intelligent handling of marriage, they may traverse so much of the spiritual path that it needs only a touch by a perfect master to raise them into the sanctuary of eternal life. I think this paragraph, is it the last? Yeah, represents the whole crux of what is the best case for married life.
Perfect.
Right? Yeah. So, we are almost out of time.
I love the word deliberate cooperation. So it's gives you the, you have to make effort.
Yeah, absolutely. Conscious and deliberate cooperation. Ashok?
I was just saying, sentence there, as you said, it's the summary and the crux, and I think they're very powerful. In fact, through the intelligent handling of marriage, they may traverse so much on the of the spiritual path that it needs only a touch by the perfect master to raise them into the sanctuary of eternal life. I think this is very powerful.
Yeah.
That's the only way also, I feel. You need a perfect master.
Indeed.
So does it mean we are on the way?
Yeah, I hope so.
Waiting for the perfect touch, perfect master.
I think he's touching us.
We are already there. You know, we are under the umbrella of the perfect master. It's just the ego has to be
there.
So all of us will be neighbors in Moksha Village.
Look forward.
Shall we start a community village?
Say again.
Not neighbors, we will all merge together into a single cell.
Super answer.
Oh my God.
Super answer.
This is another level.
And Kama has samskaras bringing up.
To struggle so much. Yeah.
Actually, today I read up, I logged in a bit late because I found a very interesting read by Baba on samskaras. You know, that we even have all the animal sanskars and everything. So I'm going to share that, online. It's really beautiful and it explains hell of a lot. You know, so I'm just going to share that after this.
Sure. Thank you. Forgot an important thing that I had to share. For tomorrow, we are just getting prepared for post-lockdown, like the rest of the world. So for tomorrow, we are doing something new. Can you see my screen now?
Yes.
This is the MBA Advancing Stream chat, right? So tomorrow we'll try to use this chat audio call, or shall we postpone it to later? Because I think the recording is important, right? Is everybody keen on having the videos available for the future?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, so I think
then I have to work with Rahul and see if you are able to do the recording in a productive manner. We'll do some tests with the free edition and then come back by the end of the week. So we still have 4 or 5 days to play with options, which all I'm trying to get to, Samira and everybody else, is a model where we are less dependent on these links and all the trouble all those problems. So I'm trying to get to a steady state, which is easier even when people are on the move, right?
What is the platform?
Same, we'll stick to the same platform.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Maybe on Saturday, Sunday, you could try this.
Yes, we'll try that. No, in fact, today we are trying this call between me, Sunil, and Kama later today. So we'll try what happens in that, just as a trial. Yeah?
Sure.
All right. So everybody have a good day ahead, and let's see you all tomorrow. Jai Baba.
Jai Baba. Thank you.
Thank you.